Today is July 22nd, and on this day in jazz in 1955, the Duke Ellington Orchestra enters the Victor Studios in New York and records Harlem Air Shaft. Before we get into the tune, let's talk about the Blanton Webster Band. So the Blanton Webster Band is probably one of the most important iterations of the Duke Ellington Band. And we're only talking a few years, 1939 to 1940, basically. And Blanton Webster, that's the bassist and tenor saxophonist, Jimmie Blanton. October 20th, 1939, Ellington's in St. Louis for just 2 weeks. Johnny Hodges is out late at night, goes and hears a 21-year-old bassist, and is blown away. Goes to the hotel, wakes up Ellington, who arrives, quote, arrives in his pajamas and top coat to the club. Now, trumpeter Ralph Porter tells this story. I got this from Terry Teachout's great Ellington book. He says this, so Duke asked Marable, that was the piano player, asked Marable if he could sit in. They knew one another well. And Duke and Blanton began playing together. Still hadn't exchanged a word. Duke kept changing keys and Blanton was on to every move. The tune ended and Marable called out, "How do you like my bass player?" And Duke coyly said, "I was just going to ask you the same question." Then he laughed and said, "He's my bass player now." Duke already had a bass player, but he added Jimmie Blanton to the band, bought him a white suit, and the next night stood him out in front of the band and featured him. Just a couple months later, Duke's regular bass player walks out on a gig, and in Duke's autobiography, he writes this. Right in the middle of the set, packs up his bass and said, "I'm not going to stand up here next to that young boy playing all that bass and be embarrassed." Hold on. A bit more to that one. He left the stand, went out the front door. I think it takes a big, big man to acknowledge the facts and take low. This was an incredible bassist in his early 20s. Ellington says about Blanton, he says, "I flipped like everybody else. We didn't care about his lack of experience. All we wanted was that sound, that beat, and those precision notes in the right places so that we could float out on the great and adventurous sea of expectancy with his pulse and foundation behind us." Ellington always had a beautiful way with words. He wastes no time recording with Blanton. In fact, the next month he records probably the first ever commercial piano-based duets. I'll link some of those below. Check those out. Now, Blanton is a classically trained bassist, and he brings out a new virtuosity in jazz bass. So check out the recording of Jack the Bear. I'll put that in the link too, from March of 1960, and you hear his bass right out in front of the Ellington Band. If you're not impressed with this, it's because every other bass player after him has to play with the same virtuosity. He is setting a total new standard for what the jazz bassist must achieve. 3 years later, Blanton dies from tuberculosis. This is one of those great tragedies in jazz, right up there with the death of trumpeter Clifford Brown. So also in late 1939, Ellington brings tenor saxophonist Ben Webster to the band. Now, Ben is one of the greatest of the early jazz tenor players you can think of. Coleman Hawkins and Lester Young, and Webster comes right after that. His sound is very similar to Hawkins as he starts with the Ellington Band, but he comes under the sway of Johnny Hodges, the great alto saxophonist in Ellington's band, and that adds great emotion to Ben Webster's playing. I'm also going to link this amazing recording that I just heard for the first time today. Jimmie Blanton and Ben Webster playing Stardust in a live show New Year's Eve, I think 1940, New Year's Eve. It's amazing that we have that recording. Check that out. I was incredibly moved just listening to that. So, this was an incredibly productive time for Ellington. In fact, he was so busy writing new works that he didn't even have time to write new tenor parts for his new tenor player. So, when they were playing the old tunes from the book, Ben Webster was just called upon to improvise and make it fit, which is an amazing thought. So let's dig into the tune at hand, Harlem Air Shaft. First thing that you might come to your mind is, what exactly is an air shaft? And in fact, I've known this tune for quite a while without knowing exactly what that was. I always thought it was some sort of airplane thing, but no, an air shaft is a space between the big apartments, especially in these big cities. So when windows became mandatory in the late 1800s, you had to have these small spaces created so that you'd have windows in all the rooms. Sometimes these spaces were so small you could reach across and touch the hand of the person across. And imagine the high rise, this would be a really vertical, high, small space. So with that in mind, here's how Ellington describes this piece. So this is his quote. Take Harlem Air Shaft. So much goes on in a Harlem Air Shaft. You get the full essence of Harlem in an air shaft. You hear fights. You smell dinner. You hear people making love. You hear intimate gossip floating down. You hear the radio. An air shaft is one great big loudspeaker. You see your neighbor's laundry. You hear the janitor's dog. The man upstairs, Ariel, falls down, breaks your window. You smell coffee. A wonderful thing is that smell. An air shaft has got every contrast. One guy's cooking dried fish with rice. Another guy's got a great big turkey. Guy with fish's wife is a terrific cooker. Guy's wife with the turkey doing a sad job. You hear people praying, fighting, snoring, jitterbugs jumping up and down, always over you, never below you. That's the funny thing about jitterbugs, always over you. And I tried to put all that in the Harlem air shaft. So an interesting question comes up. Is this a programmatic piece? Can you take what Duke just said and hear all that in the music? I don't have time to discuss all that in detail, but I'll include some links for where people are discussing that for anyone interested. But what I wanted to do is I wanted to share this piece and help our listeners understand this at a deeper level. Now I have shared this with many students over the last several years, and I've always thought of this, the intro, just 12 bars, as a table of contents. And to my great surprise, I was researching for today, I wasn't the first. Many other commentators have looked at this as a table of contents. I'll describe in just a few moments. First of all, the first 12 bars, take a listen. That's a lot of information in 12 bars. Curious to what you thought, first time listening. So let me just describe one thing you hear. First of all, you have three four-bar phrases in three very different keys. So even if you don't know much about music, you can put all 12 keys on a circle called the circle of fifths. And those keys that are close together on the circle are close together keys. The ones that are further apart, much more distant. He's using these three keys. A flat, which is on our clock, 8 o'clock. C, which is 12 o'clock. And E, which is at 4 o'clock. And so here we go. A flat. Switch to C major. Dramatic E major. Gets us back to A flat. Just making a circle. So that's one fascinating thing. So back to this table of contents. Each of those three motifs, we can call them, are going to announce the chapters that we're going to hear. So right after that, we're going to hear the first chorus. Now, these choruses are the typical song form of the day, the 32-bar AABA, which means you have an A section, the A section repeats, contrasting B section, and back to the A. 8 bars each. 8, 8, 8, 8 makes 32. So let's listen to that first 4 bars again, and here we go. Little snippet. Ba-do-ba-da, ba-do-ba-da, boop-bop. He's going to flesh that out in right here. All the saxophones play the main melody. It'll go into the B section. Let's listen to that second part of the table of contents. Saxophones playing interesting chords. Here we go. How's that going to work in our second chapter? This is my favorite part of the piece right here. It's what's called stop time. So the drums are going to go out. You're going to feel like suspension of time. I like this feeling of of hang gliding, and see if you can sense that with the saxophone chords. Time is still there. That's so fantastic. Just one concept here about the programmatic concept here. There's one thing Duke said. He said, the man upstairs, Ariel, falls down and breaks your window. That could be right there. Listen to the saxophones again, and then the way the drums come in crashing. So that's the second chapter. Let's get to the third chapter. Let's remember how he introduces it. Here we go. Trombones. Ba-da-ba-ba-da-bum. And let's hear how the third chorus begins. There you go. He set that up in the table of contents. You knew exactly what was going to happen because we read the contents. The very last chapter, he's going to play with the first idea again. So here we go. That's the way it begins. I'm going to play the ending for you, the shout chorus. All right, now, if you enjoyed that, go listen to the whole piece and enjoy one of the marvels of this Blanton Webster Ellington band. If you like what you're hearing, subscribe, tell your friends, and we'll see you next time on This Day in Jazz.